Welcome to the Association of the United States Army. Those of you who are guests, and for the AUSA team, thanks for joining us. As the AUSA team knows, that we started last month, kind of following the Army tradition of taking the opportunity to take pause from the daily grind of events and kind of follow the Army tradition of special recognitions in months. So last month, we took the occasion of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Holiday and remembrance, and we viewed and talked about the movie Selma and what that meant to all of us. And so we find ourselves in February in Black History Month. Thanks to Lieutenant General Retired Guy Swan, our Vice President for Education. And I tasked him and said, let's see if we can organize an event for Black History Month. And without missing a beat, General Swan said, I know exactly what we need to do. And it looks like his idea resonated, because other than on payday, this room has never been so full. That's right. So that's a very, very good, very, very good thing. We're certainly honored to be here. You know, I normally at events like this take the opportunity to acknowledge all of the senior officials who are present. And I'm not going to do that, because as General Ward knows, you can take a lot of time doing this. And so he and I learned in Africa this great tradition that simply says all protocol observed. All right, so we'll just abide by that. But for the general officers and others who are here, and certainly for our own team at AUSA, thanks for joining us this morning for a very special presentation. Our guest speaker, but not our lone speaker, because he brought a team with him, recognizing that this is a team sport. Some of the members of that team were recruited rather late in the game, but it nonetheless is good. When General Swan started talking about this, and he said, you know who we ought to invite to speak is General Becton. And instantaneously, all of us said, well, of course. You know, for Black History Month, who else would you want to have speak at the Association of the United States Army than a man who has lived through extraordinary change and service in our Army and across our nation? Many of you know General Becton, you know his story or parts of it. He enlisted first shortly after Christmas in 1943. And so you think about that time in that era, and one of the things to think about is, for a young black man in the United States in 1943 to say, that's what I want to do. He enlisted, began his service, went to Officer Cadet School, and if my records are correct, you were commissioned second lieutenant in 1945. That's a while back. And the Army was vastly different than it is today. Our nation was vastly different. And General Becton did all the things that you would expect of a young officer, serving in all the critical positions. He started off as a Signal Corps officer in the infantry. For reasons that baffle me, he transitioned from the infantry to the armor and cavalry. I don't really understand why anyone would make that choice, but he made that choice as squadron commander, brigade commander. I'm the president now. I can say that. And he did all those things, and then selected for promotion to brigadier general, division commander, corps commander of the, as some of us would call, the other corps in Germany in those days. And then culminated his service as deputy commanding general, training and doctrine command, retiring in 1983. But General Becton, for those of you who know him and those of you who know of him, that was not the end of his service. It was just the end of one phase of service and the beginning of yet another. He served as the director of the Office of Foreign Disaster Assistance, OFDA, Many of us in the U.S. Army didn't know that there was such a thing about AUFTA until we found ourselves engaged in military operations overseas in Iraq, Afghanistan, the Balkans, and other places. And suddenly you learn that the Office of Foreign Disaster Assistance is a pretty important place. General Becton led that office. He led FEMA, and we all know FEMA. I guess the best way to say it is you were the director of FEMA before it was cool, right? It was, but an absolutely vital part of the American fabric, Americans helping Americans when times are very tough. He was the president of Prairie View A&M University, demonstrating his leadership and academic credentials, and then served as the superintendent of Washington, D.C. schools. Probably the toughest, my guess is, he would say maybe the toughest job that he ever had was that one. So I think what you see here is the in the theme and the course of General Becton's life is the one constant is the commitment to service to others, commitment to service to the nation. And so it is my great privilege to welcome to the Association of the United States Army's celebration of Black History Month, Lieutenant General Julius Becton, United States Army, retired.
I got to walk slowly. Yeah, I'm going to use the start point. Please sit down. Going to also bring a bike up here because I have a few training aids. General Hamm, you have caused me to vary from my prepared note to respond to a couple of comments that you made. But for the record, for those who or seeing the two of us together, last Monday, Tuesday, Valentine's Day, in this very room, they had the Sergeant Major of the Army and his predecessor. And if you want to see two fine non-commissioned officers, those were the two you should see. It was an outstanding performance. But as I walked in to this room, my seat was at a table. Our number, seat number 8 at a head table grouping. And I heard somebody say, I thought, we can start now, General Becton's here. I looked around, I looked up on the screen, and there was Colonel Hamm, someplace in Missouri, and he made that statement as I walked in. That got my attention very quickly. Anyhow. Who said that? Well, naturally, former Sergeant Major of the Army. Why wouldn't he? But I have, when General Swan asked me to do this, I had no idea what I was getting into. As a matter of fact, I started thinking about, okay, what am I going to say? Because the group that he described is not the group I'm looking at right now. He described, I think, staffers in his headquarters, civilians, who were not military, had no military experience, and probably did not know much about Black Americans. And I'm telling you right now, I see more folks of color in this room than I've ever seen at any AUSA function before. Please come back. They call Art Gregg and Bob Neighbors and a few have been trying to get more folks out, and you're here. It's a great place to see, and they got good people. And so I think you're going to appreciate what they're doing at this facility. I mentioned, or it was mentioned, in fact, I have two people with me, and I brought them because I was not aware of the fact that who else was going to be here. So I asked Bob Neighbors, my former aide de camp when I was Corps commander, and our youngest daughter, Renee Strickland, who happens to be an Air Force colonel, retired. See how they treat the Air Force? She also spent a lot of time in something called NRO. And if I were to say that back when she was there, both of us would go to jail. I also was not aware of the fact that a Gordon Sullivan was going to be here. Because when I saw that, I said, hey, I got it made now. I don't really need Bob and Renee. He's going to be here. And then I heard something called the Rocks are going to be here. Well, for those who don't know what the Rocks are, I'm not going to tell you. I'll let them tell you. But I'm one of the founders of the Rocks, so they'll be very happy to tell you who they are and what they're doing. I'm not going to have much of a talk to start off with. I want to respond to your question to find out what you want to hear from me. If I can answer it, I'll do it. If I can't, I will tell you I can't answer it. As straightforward as that. I'm going to ask you to do one thing. When you ask your question, please use the mic that don't carry around, because I'm 70% hearing impaired. I wear two hearing aids, and at the age of 90, I got two excuses for not hearing what you're saying. You're laughing, but it's very true. But I went to a school at a place called Bryn Mawr, Pennsylvania, suburban Philadelphia. My father was a third grade dropout. My mother went to 10th grade. That's as far as they could go in the schools that she went to. Their idea was to have their son to go to college. And the two of us, my younger brother and I, were the first two Bectons to get a college education. And I'm so happy to say that we've got some more Bectons coming along now. And in our family, we have four daughters and a son, in that order. All are college graduates. We have our grandchildren are on their way. One is about to become a doctor herself, lawyer from the University of Virginia. She has spent time in India, Africa, doing things like that, helping people. And I could not be happier than what they're doing. But let me also drop another name while we're talking about where I went to school. I went to a place called Laura Marion High School, suburban Philadelphia. And as a name dropper, which I'm prone to be, some of the people who went to that same school wanted Hap Arnold. Hap Arnold happened to be the founder of the Army Air Corps, and he later became the commander-in-chief for the United States Army Air Force. He came at our school one day and gave us long song and dance about joining the Army Air Corps and winning your silver wing and gold bars as a pilot. And the football team got wrapped up, and we went down and took the batteries of tests. Six of us were inducted into the Army Air Corps Enlisted Reserves. Not one of us ever became pilots. I flunked out of pre-flight because I couldn't see. Stigmatism. And back in the old days, some of you old-timers may remember, they had a great big chart. When you walk into the doctor's office, you see a great big E and a few other letters. In those days, I could take one look at that, and I had that chart memorized. Cover your right eye, read that bottom line. And I gave it. And Renee is smiling because I went through this just last week, and I think I did pretty good. Thank you very much. But my eyes, my visions are corrected. Anyhow, Hap Arnold graduated from our high school, Laura Marion High School, in 1903. A fellow named Al Haig, General, Secretary of State, and he had a few challenges. At a reforger exercise, and if you don't understand the term reforger, I got a couple of folks who can tell you what reforger is. We were out in the field, and he was out there, and we had bad weather. This was in the wintertime, and the weather turned warm, and the road became muddy, and we were tearing up the crops, and we decided we better cancel this exercise. I am the exercise director, corps commander. My boss was a fellow named George Blanchard. He was a USA commander, and I said, well, I'll cancel because I'm an exercise director. Blanchard said, no, that's my job. Haig comes in, hears about this, I'll take care of that, takes care of that. While he was making that determination, we were out on a little mound talking. My staff thought we were talking about what we're doing in the exercise, the tactics, and so forth. What we really were talking about when he got kicked out of high school for smoking. He had to get his mother to bring him back in. But little things like that. Jim Billington. Who's heard of Jim Billington? He happened to be a former Librarian of Congress, a very, very long time Librarian of Congress. He is a graduate of high school, and he's done a lot of things for this organization and for the Rocks. He just retired. Dr. Charles Sumners, graduate of Lower Merion, president of Harvard. He had a little problem with, he made a few comments about female faculty members, and that didn't get very far. Another graduate of Lower Merion High School, Jim Vance, Channel 4, sports. So we have some interesting people coming from that high school, and I'm happy to say that I at least know most of them. At Lower Merion, there's something else that's taking place that just started about 2 years ago. It's called a group of Becton Scholars. They came up with a group to, using my name and the fact I went there, and recruited youngsters to begin, come in to try to become scholars and excel. Basically, minorities, not all, but primarily Spanish, Hispanic, Black Americans, and they're doing a fine job. And those are the kind of things that make me feel pretty good about what they're doing, what we're trying to do. Let me point out that the situation that the Army had in 1940 in terms of minorities, where you had segregation, Jim Crow, and those kinds of things, were established back in, basically, in the Army War College, 1925, when it was stated that African Americans were not qualified to handle sophisticated equipment or leadership positions. And the Army followed that for a very, very long time. Some of us were able to help bring about changes, and many of those folks who helped to do that are in this room right now. One other interesting thing, I never had a Black teacher in high school, in elementary school, in junior high. My first Black teacher I had was at Prairie View when I went through an ROTC duty as an instructor, or ROTC as an assistant professor of military science. And so I didn't have that opportunity to have that experience. And I tried ever since that time to do something about it. And as General Hamm mentioned, he mentioned something about D.C. public schools. What he did not say was that was the worst assignment I ever had. Not because of the kids, not because of the teachers, or the faculty, or the unions, but the Congress. Not one member of the Congress had a member in D.C. public schools. But they also knew what to do about it. One interesting story. My staff said that when I was going over for a briefing to the chairman of a committee, he said, sir, you're going to have a little problem because he does not think you should be superintendent. I never met the guy. What's he talking about? Well, go and find out what the problem is. They went over and talked and came back. You're not going to believe this, but his wife is a teacher, and she does not think any soldier should be a superintendent, particularly a general. And so I said, we got to do something about that. So I went to see a fellow named Chuck Hagel, a good friend. I said, I need some help, Chuck. For those who may not know who he is, he was a senator in those days. And after that, he happened to be the Secretary of Defense. But Chuck and I went back to the USO board when he was the chairman of the board, and I was one of the staffers. Please go and help me with this guy because he is causing me a problem. I'll take care of it. The very next time I saw this gentleman, who happened to be from Kansas, he came from behind his table and gave him a great big bear hug. We're going to make good things happen for you in the school system. The only other member who did that to me was a speaker, former speaker, a fellow named Gingrich. When I was also superintendent, he invited me over for breakfast one morning. I came in and he said, you know, I'm going to make sure something good happened for the schools every month. Yes, sir. That was in 1978, 79, something like that. I'm still looking for that one good thing he's going to make happen. I'm talking about politics, what it is in the District of Columbia trying to get things done. Okay. I came to respond to your questions, and I had, as I said, Renee, our daughter, Bob Neighbors, our very best friend, not best, pretty good fellow, though, to help respond. And when I heard that Gordon Sullivan was going to be here, I also asked him, would you be willing to say something, whatever it is? And I see he got tapped out, and so when they speak, I have no idea when they're going to speak or what they're going to say. But let's start off with questions, and then from there we'll see what happens. Who had the first question? I don't believe that. Oh, there's a hand up.
Hello. What was the most rewarding aspect of your career?
Would you say that again, please? Keep in mind now, I said speak slowly so I can understand you.
What was the most rewarding aspect of your career?
The most rewarding aspect of my career. When I had an assignment as a commander and my family was there, those things made a big difference. Sitting in this group now are some people who are with me in 7th Corps, Stuttgart, Germany. Could not have been a better place to be. We had a mayor named Rommel, Oberbürgermeister. Rommel had a relationship with us that if something happened to an American soldier, whether it was he couldn't get a ride in a taxi, couldn't get service in a hotel or a restaurant or whatever, if we told him about that, the very next day, that person got a visit by the inspector for transportation, a food service, or whatever. And it made things much better for a lot of us there. And we had good people. We had fun doing what we're doing. And we enjoyed having things like Reforger, bringing the type units in from the United States, 1st Division, whoever else came in. And we're professional soldiers. And we had the guys on the other side. They knew that we were prepared. And I'm happy to say that was a Cold War, and I don't think they attacked. But the reason they didn't, we had some interesting plans for them. And interesting plans, by the way, was prepared by a fellow named Gordon Sullivan, who was the G3 of that Corps. And he can explain how he got to become G3. That's another story. The other best assignment, 2nd Squadron, 17th Cav. Airborne Unit, 101st Airborne. We went from Campbell to Vietnam. And we basically won our battle that we tried, we were engaged in. And some of the people here were in that unit. The interesting part about that, I had to renew my parachute qualification once I joined the unit because I had not jumped off an airplane in a long time. I was in country, and I was jumping off a helicopter. And I, sitting in the side of that chopper, had about 1,300. I'm looking down, and I don't like heights. Now, you're laughing, but I don't like heights. Simple as that. And I said to myself, what in the hell am I doing here? On the right, I had one of my sergeant major. On my left, I had my operations sergeant. I had nothing to do, but okay. The pilot said, jump, went out. But I got that done, like, therefore got back on jump status. That's money, in case you don't understand that. And we had a great time. They were convinced that I would do it. I was convinced I did it. And that takes care of that. When you're a soldier, understand you can do what they're doing. That did it. One other example about when I did something not very smart. General Hamm mentioned the fact I was a Signal Corps officer. I became a Signal Corps officer because at the end of the war, World War II, I was sent into the 93rd Division. Now, not many of you could be in the 93rd Division because it's an all-black division. That division was always co-located with the 31st Division, Dixie Division from North National Guard Unit. Why the Army ever did that, I'll never understand. But wherever the 93rd went, they went, parallel. And when they were not fighting the battle, they're fighting each other. As a young lieutenant coming in, I and an officer from the Dixie Division were put together in a Jeep, and we had to go around to make sure that we could keep peace. And we did a pretty good job of that. But when that division deactivated, I did not have enough points to come home. I was sent to Manila, Philippines, assigned to a signal unit. And I learned how to climb poles. Now, there are some signal officers who understand what I'm talking about.
Sure.
One of the things I found out, there were four other lieutenants, all combat armed, just like from 93rd Division, and they would not climb. And my soldier expected me to climb, so I learned how to climb. And I did. My most challenging thing I ever did was climb a 100-foot pole. We put that pole in for antenna for the local radio station so they could broadcast to the wherever they do in radio station. And I got to tell you, a 100-foot pole with 10 feet in the ground, 90 feet above the ground, the one thing you don't want to do, if something so happens, you don't want to grab the pole because that's the worst thing you can do. You get splinters all the way down. You push out away from the pole and let your feet gaff into the pole, and you come down gently. I said, I don't like heights. That's the last time I climbed a pole like that. We had a good unit, we had good people, and we still stay in contact to this day. I think I answered your question. Who asked that question? Okay. Yes, sir.
Sir, my name is Major Andy Rohr. I'm actually the Army Fellow that's at AUSA for a year. I'll leave in July and go to Germany, to Stuttgart, as a matter of fact. But before I proceed to Germany, I'd like to know from you about your experience at the Officer Candidate School. I was commissioned through the Officer Candidate School, and I did a little bit of research on the Officer Candidate School, realized that that was actually the first desegregated unit in the Army prior to Truman's order desegregating the entire armed forces. What was your experience going to school in a desegregated unit on a segregated post in the South and then departing from that and returning into the segregated Army?
Thank you, because I have that as a note to mention, but I would have forgotten about it. What he is saying, Fort Benning, Columbus, Georgia, you can't get much more in the South than a place like that, and with the rules that they have, segregation, Jim Crow, and all the other things. On the post, you still had restrictions. In the movies, you go to a regular theater, there's a place for us to sit, Army post. But in the OCS element at Fort Benning, they were completely integrated. The housing, the billets, where you ate, who you slept next to, where you went together and trained. With all that, we were could not have been better. And keep in mind, I came from a place called Montgomery County, Lower Marion Township, Pennsylvania. And that was integrated enough, but not to the extent that we'd had down at Fort Benning. could not have asked for anything better than that. But once you set foot outside of the officer candidate school area, you're back into the restrictions. You could not go to the restaurant. You could not go to the theater. You could not ride. You could not restroom at all. And the Army made it very good for us. Another interesting thing, at Fort Benning, the main club was across the street from the schools, for the infantry school. I could not go to the officer club except to pay my bills for staying or playing or going to the club at Shady Hunk, which is the post off the post, off the main post for where blacks could go. But we had to pay our bills at the main club. It's interesting when you sit in the off in the class and look at that place across the street. It's a beautiful building, but it's you could not go there. I'm happy to say I've been through, most old things have gone away. They all have gone away as far as I know. But the officer candidate facility, the training that we got, the person you live next door to, next bunk to, it worked. Another interesting thing while I'm on that subject, I mentioned being an officer candidate, or rather aviation cadet, and my first station was Keesler Field, Biloxi, Mississippi. A great place for a young black and 18 years old to go to in those days. When I flunked out of the program because I couldn't see, right before we left, there were a couple of us. George Barber and myself were walking down the street in Biloxi on pavement against the street stores, talking to us about what we're doing, and we heard behind us a rattle. There are two of them. And we saw a truck coming down on the pavement towards us. We backed up against the store window just as close as we could get, that window, and a truck went by without hitting us. And there's no doubt in my mind, what they were going to do to us. With that, we got, as soon as we could, back on the post at Keesler Field, never went back to Keesler Field again, until years later, when I was the deputy commander of TRADOC, now a lieutenant general, I flew back down into Keesler Field or Biloxi in my Army aircraft. I landed at the main airport. I was met by the state AG as in general. I had state trooper escort from the airport to the hotel where I was speaking to a National Guard and reserve officers. And I started my comment by saying, "Mind how things have changed." But those are the kind of things, some of the experiences that we've had. Did I answer your question? Yes, sir. I'm not going to ask the lady in front of you to speak because I want to talk about her.
Sir, I'm interested in asking you, what originally motivated you to join the military in that era of segregation, and how did you feel about that in your heart at the time when you first came in?
Well, you heard me say that my father was a third grade dropout, a janitor in an apartment building in Bryn Mawr, Pennsylvania. My mother, 10th grade, because her school didn't go any higher. And she was determined that her two sons get an education because she knew the importance of it. And she worked very hard at it. I played football, did a pretty good job with my dad. But I could not play football one day if I did not have a B average, because she knew that I could not get into college unless I had a grade point average that's that high. And so when I came home from school, she took care of that. Sit down. What are you supposed to do in homework? And we went over that. Not all bad for a 10th grade person herself. She was the one that drove my brother Joe and me to get an education. We went to school. And then we found out that when I went to OCS, by the way, when I went there, I enjoyed what I was doing when I became a second lieutenant. I enjoyed being in the Army. I did not want to become a school teacher. I did not want to go out there and become anything. I just enjoyed being around soldiers. And in 1983, when Truman signed the executive order, 9981, that's when I volunteered to come back on active duty. Now a signal officer, because I had to stay in the reserve signal, and to be recalled and apply for a regular Army appointment. And I went on something called competitive tour. And that's where they took all the officers who were interested in becoming regular Army, and we were competing against each other. They took about a couple hundred each year, and we were competing against other. And from that group, they selected some to become regular Army. As a matter of fact, I suspect one or two of you were on competitive tour too. I just enjoyed being a soldier. I enjoyed meeting people. I enjoyed being with people. And we knew what our missions were. And I was in pretty good physical condition. I used to challenge my soldiers. You get a higher score than I do, then you have a day off. And I did that one day in the training center. And my battalion commander came around. Where are your people? What do you mean, sir, I? This is what I told him. If they get a better score than I did on a PT test, they can have the afternoon off. And he sat there and smiled. They beat you, didn't they? Yes, sir, they did. But guess what? We got a better physical training group than anyone else in this battalion. And we did. That's what we're about. It's about being around people, leadership, and just, we know what our mission is, very clear. In combat, there's no doubt about what we'd have to do. You go out and find them and make it work. Answer your question?
Can I add to that? It's an editorial. I think my mic is on. Y'all can hear me, right?
You want to stand up so they see who
you are?
I'll
stand up briefly. I'm daughter number four. If you all have not had the opportunity to read Becton, the book, I encourage you to do so, not just to plug the book, but because the stories, and he won't get to all of them, are incredible. My sisters and my brother and I did not know half of what he went through in those early years. To your point about why in the world a young man, a young black man from the main line outside of Philadelphia would join an army before segregation was no more. First of all, World War II, right? Everybody was going to fight, so you don't have much of a choice. But why would he go back in to serve his country knowing that he was going to be treated as a second-class citizen? He never talked about those things when we were growing up because I think at the end of the day, they didn't matter. He did not belabor the fact that he would be, you know, riding on a train from Fort Benning back up to Philadelphia and be told by the conductor, boy, you can't sit there as a lieutenant, you know, told you got to move. He wouldn't tell us those kinds of stories because that's not what mattered to him. What mattered to him was being a soldier and serving. So he did what he did because he loved the Army, he loved the people, and he loved his country. That's what mattered to him. And that's why he continues to do all the stuff that he does.
I mentioned the fact that she is an Air Force colonel, retired, and some friends asked me, why did you let your daughter go to Air Force? Four-year scholarship. And do you have a copy of her bio? Is it one in there? Okay. Well, it's a very interesting one, and they have copies of her someplace. Anyhow, read it. You can't ask for them. She had more degrees than the rest of the family have. But she also spent time with NRO, National Reconnaissance Office. Mm-hmm. If I were to say that back when she was in that job, I would be in deep trouble, and she would be too. But they're the ones who used to, among other things, track the bad guys' missiles as they're floating around up there to protect us. Let me take a time to point out some other things. Her oldest sister, pediatric nurse practitioner here at Fort Myer, the only member that's working, and she's the oldest. She's having fun too. Her number two sister is retired, Department of Treasury, IRS. And she won't mention that to you public, but you got it. The number three daughter was a manager at Andrews AFIS PX system. Today, she is a project manager for American University, and I have the title of her book, I mean her job, but basically it helping people to get employment when they leave school. She's number four, and our youngest member, our son, he's a medical administrator. His name is Julius Wesley Becton III, and he was never convinced when he was growing up in the Army. He went to ROTC at Valley Forge Military Academy, first captain at Valley Forge Military Academy. They went to George Washington, met his love wife. They got together, married, and he was never convinced that what he accomplished was on his own, because what was his name? Julius Wesley Becton Jr. And every general officer and every command sergeant major would make a point. How's your father? How's he doing? When he was in the old guard, he was the commander of the honor guard company, and he went to MDW as assistant three. While he was out there preparing the Pentagon parade field for a parade that they have at the Pentagon, up come 2 4-stars, chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff and the Chief of Staff of the Army. And he remembers it. They walked up to him and said, Wesley, how you doing? Fine, sir. How's your father? Fine, sir. And how's your mother? Now, he's trying to get the parade ground fixed. He's trying to get a few other things done. And these 4 stars are really helping him. Finally, he said, sir, I got to go to work. And he went back to work. But he's comfortable. And one of the things that Renee mentioned, Louise and I feel very good about who they are, what they are, because they're comfortable around people. No matter what the grade may be, they know what they're capable of doing. And we have some other people sitting here. This lady sitting over here, she was a second lieutenant in 7th Corps when I first met her. And if she wanted to tell a story, she would let her tell it. But her husband is sitting next to her now. He can tell that one too. Bob Neighbors helped her to understand what it means to be told to do something by a Corps commander. Okay. Yes, ma'am. You need a mic. Hello, Creighton.
Thank you.
I didn't see you sitting there.
I have a question concerning President
Clinton. Could you talk to me because they can't?
Can you hear me?
Yes. Now they can.
I have a question concerning President Truman's decision to integrate the armed forces. First part, how was that policy conveyed down the chain of command? And how was the policy actually implemented? And what were some of the challenges faced by the U.S. Army?
That's a great question. I was on active duty for training when the issue order came out. I was at Aberdeen Proving Ground. And the order came out, and all the commanders were told, read this to your soldiers. and the post commander assembled all the officers and non-commissioned officers together in a theater at Aberdeen Proving Ground. He read Executive Order 9981. And at the end of that, he said, as long as I'm the commander here, there'll be no change. Simple as that. And it took some time for people to really follow that through. But some of us, to me, that was what I wanted to hear, an opportunity to come back in and see if I could do it. I'm smiling at a fellow right behind you. He was also in 7th Corps. He's also in charge of historical. Historical Foundation, Army Historical Foundation. And they need money. What else do you need, Creighton, while you're talking about it?
More money. I don't need money. Just one comment. I have read the book. And his daughter nailed that book. It is relentlessly upbeat for exactly the reason she said. All he went through, it just didn't matter. But it's an amazing book. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. The one thing I like about that book, the foreword was written by my wife. And when I went to the publisher, they said, who's going to write the foreword? My wife. No, but who's going to? Listen to me. Louise Becton is going to write that. And once you read it, then you're going to understand why I was so happy that she wrote it. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I'm Ray Omfroy, Lieutenant Colonel retired. And it's a special joy and privilege to have you talk today. But our paths crossed at previous time. I was attending the armor course at Fort Knox, and you were, I think, had just left command of the division or were in the division at the time. And so you were the guest speaker. We had a mutual friend, Billy McGowan. I hope it's
okay.
Good. I hope it's good news.
Billy's a good man.
Yeah. But what I'm really interested in is the story you told while you were guest speaking. Had to do with a horse and you're getting upon it. I don't know if you're willing to share that short experience. However, it was a total joy to have heard it then, at least what I did hear. So here's an opportunity maybe for you to come back to it.
Why do it on page 126, isn't it? For those who have not seen that picture, let me hold my barter book for a minute.
Yes, sir.
The top picture here, a horse on his hind legs. Now, this came about, we decided to have a review, division review. Because there was a fuel shortage, we could not bring our tanks and stuff out. Troop march, and I, at the end, when it got to for passing review, for reviewing the troops, rather, I trooped the line, mounted. Now, at the time, we had about 6 senior NCOs who had retired, and we wanted to demonstrate for them what the Army looked like at that time. And they were in a mule pull wagon. And unbeknownst to me and a few other people, my G2 thought it'd be a great idea to get a picture of this division on march, on parade. Whole division mounted, on the ground. And this group from Austin came in and took a picture. Were you there, Preston?
I was.
By the way, he's also a member of organization, former Sergeant Major in the Army. Hua. At the time I got to get on the back of old Bill, and this is old Bill, this jets came in and to take pictures. and the matched mules, which are pulling the wagon behind me, caused the horse to spook. And the end result, this horse got up on his hind legs. Now, my instructor for riding, and I'm from suburban Philadelphia, I've never been on the back of a horse before, took his shoemaker, Corps Commander's wife, taught me how to ride. She never told me what to do when a horse reared up like that. The best thing to do is just drop the reins, and it'll settle back down. But if you take a real close look at the picture, I am so intent on staying straight in the saddle, I'm pulling the horse over his head this way. And that's what happened. If you go to the next picture, you can see it. It's on the ground. And I got back on that horse because I had my leg hurt too much to walk out there and check the folks. I had too much pride to get into the wagon. Only thing left to do, get back on that horse, and that's what I did. There are some people who were in the audience who are with me even to this day. His predecessor here, Jack Merritt, and I remind him of it, Chuck Heimaker. He was a sergeant mate. He was the provost marshal at Fort Hood, both living where we do right now. The only problem is that picture you just saw, the first picture was in the Austin American, front page, the next day, implying that the horse threw me. And if you take a look at this third picture, I'm on the ground, I still got my Stetson hat on, and I was saying, stall in the saddle, and feel pretty good at what we did. Do I like horse riding now? No. But if necessary, soldiers expect you to do that, you get back on the horse. This is going to be a trouble. Who had the mic?
Sure, I've got a quick question. You relayed, you know, where we were as a country when you first came in, and where we are now, and a lot of those advances because of what you've done. But where are we going in the future? What still needs to be done?
That's a good question. About 89, the Congress directed the military to have a study on diversity. And the military got people together, a total of 32 of us. And let me show you what the publication looks like, to evaluate what is the future and what we can do in terms of diversity. And it defined diversity. There it is. It defined diversity in a very interesting manner. It's not a racial thing. It's an economic thing. Because you're interested in your unit being diverse, you want to take advantage of their entire background. And this study had some 32 people titled from representation to inclusion. Who are some of the people that were part of the study? The chairman of it was Les Lyles, 4-star Air Force, former Vice Chief of Staff. The current Commandant of Marine Corps was part of it. The 32 names, when you reach a certain age of 90, you forget whose names are. But anyhow, we made almost a year and a half study, and our letter to the president and to the Congress, in effect, and by the way, this book is in libraries, most military libraries, and you can go online and get copies of it, read it. But we just, in effect, advised the president what we found. And we were rather excited about what we found. We can take credit, whether you like it or not, for women doing what they're doing today. And we feel very good about that. When Michelle Howard pinned on that 4-star, we could not have been happier. By the way, she's a Navy Vice CNO. Because she's qualified. All we were asking for, maintain the standards. And if they're qualified, fine. One of the persons where I live is a fellow 3-star. He sounded off one day at a Rotary meeting about what he thought about women in the military. And some of us got upset. I got so upset, Louis said, please, please, just sit down. Don't say anything. We had a long conversation with him. His view were women had no place being in the Army. Why? Because of whatever mindset he had from his experience. My position is, if they're qualified, fine. And you heard me say I have a 4 daughters and a son. And I have my daughters qualified to do whatever they want to do. And my wife, well, I can only say that her, we celebrated our 89th anniversary.
69.
69, excuse me.
69.
That's why we got them here. Our 69th anniversary last Sunday. Two Sundays ago. Let me tell you about that young lady. She has a birthday coming up on the 1st of March. I got that right?
You did.
And why did I get that right? Because her birthday is 28th February. She was a cadet nurse back when they had cadet nurses, but never came on active duty because they were too busy doing something else. Her first duty assignment was a hospital where they have mental problems. And throughout her career, she worked at various places. At one time, she was the acting dean of nurses at Prairie View A&M because the dean had to go to complete her doctoral studies. And so they asked Louise to step in. Her last assignment, hospice. And she's one of the founders, as Bob found out, over at hospital. What's the name of the hospital? North, it was Northern Virginia. Whatever it is. But I could not do hospice work. I don't have a mental set for it.
Capital Caring Hospice Facility.
Tell them.
Capital Caring Hospice Facility.
Okay.
My mind works slower right now this morning. It took me a while to remember.
And she left that position many years ago, and that group today still stay together, Christmas cards, birthdays, exchanging. And just think about people like that willing to do that kind of work. So that's the kind of woman that I was forced enough to marry. Long story about how that happened. We went to rival high schools. In suburban Philadelphia, I went to a place called Laura Marion, she went to a place called Radnor. And Laura Marion used to beat up on her football team, their football team, every year. And I did play football. And I did a little bragging about every time we did beat up on them. But she all of a sudden recognized that, maybe it's not all that bad anyhow. And as I said, Renee said, we celebrated our 69th anniversary last Sunday. What was the question?
It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter.
What? Yes, ma'am. Last question.
Sir, I just want to follow up on that young lady's question over there that had to do with integration in 1948. Being a student of history, I have read a lot about that particular period of time and talked to some old soldiers who were there. And they really say that the integration of units really came on the battlefields of Korea.
Let me, on that. Those, you heard a question in the rear? Mm-hmm. That question was raised by Clara Adams Ender, former chief nurse in the Army Medical Corps. At one time, she was commander of something called Fort Belvoir. You didn't think I remember that. And she has been around doing a whole bunch of things and done a whole lot to help us to be where we are. I think you're referring to an article that was published in Army Magazine back in May, March, something. And it talked about a story, and I was a lieutenant, and the 2nd Division, 2nd Infantry Division, and we were in Korea. And that's when we got a butt kicked in Korea, and the North Koreans had pushed down to the Naktong River. They set up the Pusan perimeter, and my unit got the mission of attacking a hill. I think the number was 201. The problem with that, not all of the people on sides, our sides, right and left, knew that we're making this attack. And so not only were the bad guys firing at us, our friendly fires were also firing at us. And so we had a challenging time. But we were able to push up into the hill and eventually secure the area, which started to move forward north as we were pushing the North Koreans back. I happened to have been, like I said, a lieutenant. We had good soldiers who knew what they had to do. We had trained hard at it, and we worked at it. During that period, several of us got wounded, quite a few of us. But the bad guys didn't know that. And we finally stayed long enough at the article written by Lieutenant General Dan Bolger. By the way, I've never met him, and I've been asking to meet him, and I keep saying, Ann, where can I find him? And she sent me his telephone number and stuff like that. He's down in Florida right now, I'm told. But we were able to hold a position and help to get the effort started. And it worked. That's the best proof of it. Did we have the idea in mind when we went up there? No, far from it. We were told to go and attack, and we did. But I've been told to attack other places too, and the guy had no idea, had no idea what we were attacking into. We got our butt kicked. Matter of fact, I got my second wound from one of those examples. Somebody said, there's nothing up there. But may I do one other thing before you set me down? You have a fellow over here who I asked to be here, and he has written notes, and I can tell by his frown and his glasses, and his name is a former Chief of Staff of the United States Army, 34th? 32nd. I should know that because license plate said that. let my good friend, Gordon Sullivan, who I first met when he was a major and I was a colonel, and I was able to convince to become my G3 when I was 7th Corps commander. And those who get ahead. Gordon Sullivan.
In deference to General Becton and the others like myself who may be a little hard of hearing, I'll use it. I'm going to make it short. I was once asked by a historian, Do you have any people who have been special to you in your career? And I said yes to that question. Briefly stated, General Becton is one of three I would talk about. And you just heard the reason why. I worked for General Becton the first time 42 years ago as a major in Armor Branch over in the old Tempo. They're not there anymore, it's a parking lot. And on Saturday night, you can feel like you're in Vietnam down there, but it was worse then than it is today, but it was dangerous down Turkey Point. We moved to the Hoffman Building. I didn't know General Becton. I knew him by reputation because I was in Armor Branch at the time when he came. It was special. He is a special leader in every way. So I knew him then, and we kept in touch. I became the G3 of the 3rd Infantry Division, and 1st Infantry Division, and he called me up one day and said, I'd like you to be the G3 of 7th Corps. I was a lieutenant colonel. I was not on the promotion list to colonel. Obviously, since I wasn't, I hadn't commanded a brigade or even thought of commanding a brigade. I think I said, sir, give me a break. He said, don't worry about it, I'll make it happen. He did. Amazing. Someday, you might learn how he did it. I'm not sure how he did it, but he did. And what it, you heard, you saw it today. All you have to be is around him to know what our Army is all about and what this country is all about. It's about treating people with dignity and respect. It's about keeping your eye on the ball, and it's about accepting that disagreement is not disrespect. You see that? How it works? Disagreement is not disrespect, and he lived it. If you are in his presence, you can feel greatness. That's why he is one of my favorite people and why he was so influential in my life. I would like someone to say someday, we know why you are like you are. And I would like them to say it's because of the fact that you worked with Lieutenant General Julius Becton. One of the most wonderful soldiers I know in each and every way. He's courageous, he's compassionate, and he has fun. He has fun. He enjoys life, and those who work with him enjoy life. And if you can't laugh about some of the stuff that happens in the Army, you ain't never gonna make it, baby. This is a true American hero, and I am honored to be here and honored to tell him that in front of all of you. Thanks, General Becton, to you and Louise and your whole family for what you represent. You went through hell for the U.S. Army, and we know it. And you never lost your love of America. And that says tons about you and some of the other people in this room who I could name. God bless you. Thanks, Joe Sullivan. Joe Becton, again, thank you on behalf of all of us at the Association of the United States Army. Thanks for honoring us with your presence. The one thought that kept going through my mind is, think how far you could have gone if you'd stayed in the infantry. Yes, sir, I got it. General Becton has very kindly agreed to stay on. His book is available for purchase. Those of you who need to purchase one or have one, he has kindly agreed to stay on and sign those for you after today's event. So again, thank you all for joining us. Sir, I would say simply, as a guy who has the privilege of having followed General Sullivan as the president of this association, thanks. Not so much for today, though today was wonderful. Thanks for getting us to this point. There's lots of work still to be done. That's to be sure, and you've reminded us of that. But you've also reminded us of how far we have come as an Army and as a nation. And for that, we have you to thank. You've made each of us who you have touched individually or indirectly, you have made us better. You have made our Army better, and indeed, you have made this great country stronger. Thank you for all of that.